This episode is brought to you by Experian. Are you paying for subscriptions you don't use, but can't find the time or energy to cancel them? Experian could cancel unwanted subscriptions for you, saving you an average of $270 per year and plenty of time. Download the Experian app. Results will vary. Not all subscriptions are eligible. Savings are not guaranteed. Paid membership with connected payment account required.
From your favorite source for Chicago White Sox talk, delivering news, interviews, analysis, and more. This is the Sox Machine Podcast with your hosts, Jim Margalus, James Fegan, and Josh Nelson.
Thanks, Rob, and welcome to a special edition Sox Machine Podcast. I'm your host, Josh Nelson. It's Monday night, July 29, 2024. As we record this episode, the Chicago White Sox just made their first trade before the deadline. And boy, it's a doozy. There's a lot of pieces involved. A three-team trade along with the St. Louis Cardinals and the Los Angeles Dodgers. For the White Sox part, they send starting pitcher Erick Fedde to St. Louis along with Tommy Pham. There's cash considerations that the White Sox would be sending the Cardinals as well. And the White Sox are sending Michael Kopech to the Los Angeles Dodgers. The Dodgers are receiving from St. Louis Tommy Edman, who has been a very useful super utility infielder for the Cardinals. However, Edman hasn't played a game this season as he's recovering from injury. And the Dodgers also receive 17-year-old pitcher Oliver Gonzalez. And the Dodgers will be sending a player to be named later and cash considerations to the Cardinals. The White Sox are receiving from the Los Angeles Dodgers Miguel Vargas, a former top prospect in Major League Baseball, and 19-year-old infielders Alexander Albertas and Jarrell Perez. The White Sox are not receiving anything from the St. Louis Cardinals. The White Sox general manager, Chris Getz, spoke with the media prior to Monday night's game, and he shares how the deal came to be and the impact Erick Fedde, Michael Kopech, and Tommy Pham had with the organization.
It's easier said than done to get a three-way trade to the finish line because, you know, you've got so many different variables, moving parts, working through that process. And we had been at it for close to a week to 10 days, at least talking different concepts. And we were able to get it to the finish line today. And I look back at where we were at opening day with, the players that we moved on from today and traded to other clubs, whether, Erick, Tommy, Michael, and going back to the winter meetings when we signed Erick Fedde and having that conversation and explaining to everyone, why we were signing Erick Fedde, even though he had a fantastic year in the KBO and what we saw in him. And I'm really proud of what he was able to accomplish on his journey back to the big leagues. And in talking to Erick, he was very thankful to be able to get back to the big leagues and establish himself as a top of the rotation type arm in a short period of time. With the current state of our organization, where we were in the off season to where we are now, with the idea of identifying players like Erick and be able to more or less drive a value up of a player to be able to bring in prospect capital in which we were able to do. So really proud of doing that. Obviously, Michael, we've had for a longer time in our organization. He was in the minor leagues. I just started as a farm director when we acquired him. It might have been one of my first phone calls, acquisition phone calls to welcome him in. And, it hasn't been smooth sailing for him, and he's grown up a lot, both on and off the field. I'm proud of Michael and the person that he's become. I know in talking to him, he felt like, he wanted to give more to the White Sox. Felt like he could have given more, but I certainly didn't want him to feel like he let anyone down because he's accomplished a lot. I mean, I guess in kind of recent history here, where he was at the end of the season and trying to get him to the finish line, you know, as a starter, we gave him a taste of the bullpen where we were at spring training and established himself as a pretty solid reliever, even dominant at times. You know, as an organization, we felt like we, you know, drove up his value as well and was able to capitalize that for the long-term health of the organization. And Tommy, we didn't even have Tommy at opening day. And the bolt, or I should say the jolt that he gave to our offense when he came over here was well needed. You know, he the way he goes about his business as a hitter, as a professional, was welcomed. We will miss him, but also, you know, I look back and feel like we got a lot out of Tommy Pham and was able to, you know, package him in this deal as well to, you know, once again, help the long-term health of our organization.
Erick Fedde, the 2023 Korean Baseball MVP, had a MLB career season in 2024 with the White Sox prior to being traded. According to BaseballReference.com, Fedde was worth 4.6 WAR in 21 starts and gave what the White Sox desperately needed with 121 innings, a 3.11 ERA, with 108 strikeouts and 34 walks. On Fangraphs, Fedde was worth 2.7 WAR, so there's a pretty big difference between Baseball Reference and Fangraphs. However, that 2.7 WAR is good for 19th in Major League Baseball. Now he heads to St. Louis, not just for the remaining 2024 season, but also 2025, as he's owed just $7.5 million. Fedde shared what the experience of being traded is like and the journey he's been on the past 2 years.
I'm definitely happy for it to be done. One of those things where it's obviously tough leaving a lot of my friends, but you know, I already talked to a lot of people with the Cardinals, and it seems like, you know, welcoming me with open arms, and I'm really excited, you know, to make a push for a deep run in October. You know, we all have these dreams of what our careers will look like from the beginning. They don't always go that way, but you know, just to be able to get back to this point to where, you know, you feel like watching your name circle on the news and love lots of teams. I mean, it's, in that sense, it's a dream come true. But, you know, just happy that the work I put in has paid off, and you know, I'm ready to keep doing my job.
On the format of this deal, Getz explained why he had to include someone like Tommy Pham to get this trade across the finish line.
When you're talking about expiring contracts on players, there was interest, you know, in Tommy Pham in a single team deal, so to speak, or on his own, but it wasn't going to bring as much value as we felt like we got in this deal. You know, the expiring contract, right-handed bat, you know, in all honesty, it has its limitations on a return. That's just how the market has been for years and was playing out this year, or this deadline. So we felt like it made the most sense to get this deal to the finish line with Tommy in it.
What's more important is who are the White Sox getting in return in this trade? All three players were part of the Los Angeles Dodgers system, which comes again as a surprise. The White Sox, again, are not acquiring anyone from St. Louis. So Getz shares what he likes about the new prospects coming from the Dodger system.
You know, Miguel Vargas, the I'd say people that are fans are probably more familiar with him because he's been in the big leagues. He hasn't gotten a clear runway at the major league level, and he's one of the younger, brighter bats in our game. And you know, the way that he puts together at bats, his zone awareness, his contact ability, his power potential. You know, we're a team that ranks at the bottom offensively, and so our focus was to find bats through our acquisition process here at the trade deadline, and we'll continue to be able to inject three offensive players into our organization. I think is a wise move. You know, Vargas obviously is further along in his career, and will be in our lineup here at some point in the coming days. And look forward to getting his major league journey going as a getting everyday at bats. And Gerald Perez, he played in the Futures game, another guy that's you know, got a bright future, high ceiling. He can be an impactful offensive force, plays the middle infield. He's got zone control, and he's got bat to ball, and really loves to get after it. the makeup's really strong there. And Alexander Albertus is another guy that's just getting his minor league career going. He got off to a great start in the ACL. Our scouts were raving about him analytically. He looks strong too. So to get those three, we felt like was a very, very good return, especially considering where we were in opening day, and using some of the players that have become something to acquire talent.
Joining me to discuss the trade, how it works for the White Sox, and debate if this was a good deal or not, is the managing editor of SoxMachine.com. It's Jim Margalus. And hello, Jim. Chris Getz's first midseason trade is a doozy, including Erick Fedde, Tommy Pham, and Michael Kopech in the same deal. What are your first impressions of the trade?
I thought the Cardinals did really well. If we were Cardinals machine, I think we'd be very thrilled saying that, wow, Erick Fedde, great mid-rotation starter. Even if you like think that there might be a little bit of regression in the second half as people get used to his kitchen sink approach or as the innings pile up. Tommy Pham, credible outfielder. They know him well. Your right fielder, finding a corner, can occasionally stand in center, gets on base at a league average clip, occasionally hits for power, as long as you know what his personality is like and can adjust for the intensity as he's known for, then sure, nice player to have when you have a need in the outfield. So great move for the Cardinals. For the White Sox, though, I wish we could be, or at least I wish I could be, as enthusiastic, but I'm more or less kind of confused by it and a little bit underwhelmed.
Yeah, I agree with you. And with our instant reaction on Twitter, for those that follow us on social media at Sox Machine or follow me at SoxMachine_Josh, our quick Twitter poll, thoughts on the White Sox three-team trade with St. Louis and the Los Angeles Dodgers, with the options being good trade, bad trade, WTF, and undecided. WTF, out of 1,600 votes online, is running away with it, with 43.8% of getting the vote and undecided at 28%. My thoughts about this trade, like the initial thought, Jim, is how does St. Louis get so much for giving up so little?
Yeah.
Tommy Edman is a good player. Tommy Edman has played zero games this season. Tommy Edman has one more year left on his contract. He will be owed $9.5 million in 2025. And they also, the Cardinals send a 17-year-old pitcher over to the Los Angeles Dodgers that wasn't covered as much in Oliver Gonzalez. So that's what the Cardinals sent to the Dodgers. How do the White Sox not get anyone though, Jim, from St. Louis? Like, they're the ones that are giving St. Louis Fedde and Pham. How do they, and the White Sox have to send cash to St. Louis as well, which I'm assuming is to pay for some of the cost of trading Tommy Pham. I think he gets like $500,000 if he gets traded. So the White Sox help pay for that cost. Like, I've just, that's the part where I'm confused. I'm not sure how the White Sox don't get anyone from St. Louis.
Yeah, it's the cash is funny just because I guess the cash in one hand, if I were to play devil's advocate, is a slightly heartening, because the White Sox are not like, it's not a salary dump. The White Sox are actually willing to facilitate a deal by including some money. So I guess that's good in a way that they're not trying to staple a bad salary to it or something like that and lower the return. So on that front, I guess that's good or fine. I think just on the whole, having seen some other deals roll in and seeing, recognizing some prospect names, whereas with the Dodgers, I did not recognize any of the prospects included. I did not recognize, 19-year-old A-ballers who are just in rookie ball. That's not to say that nothing will come of them, but, having seen, what the Blue Jays just got for Yusei Kikuchi, a rental, older pitcher from the Astros, a major league ready pitcher, a major league ready outfielder, first baseman, DH type, and then Will Wagner as well, another infielder. Then having seen what the White Sox had, certainly like a high risk. The White Sox didn't need major league ready guys right now. I think, ideally, if I were to draw it up, it would be like double A would be the kind of window I'd be looking at. Buy him a year, give me a year to develop with the rest of the core. Don't, have a timetable that might age quickly, and then all of a sudden they're not at their peak when the rest of the White Sox talent is coming up. The White Sox do assemble enough talent. But it feels like with the White Sox, they got young players, 19-year-olds in low A, but not huge ceilings, it seems. Like they're kind of third baseman or second baseman. They're not like the shortstop who can play center field, up the middle, speed merchant, don't exactly know, ball from a strike yet, but have all tons of power and physical tools. It seems like they're more advanced bat types that have some athleticism, but also just, nobody knows that the swing's going to hold up as they go up the levels. And if it doesn't, then they're going to be utility types. And that's, I think, a little bit more confusing to me. It's not just the profile, but the fact that they're not just the age and the distance from the majors, but also like the lack of the kind of superlative athleticism that you normally see with this kind of, long shot up, like Sammy Zavala, the third player included in the Dylan Cease trade. That's kind of more what I had in mind, like play a center field, big power, if he can access it in games. He has some big tools and some big question marks. These guys have, I guess, smaller question marks, but also a lot less on the tool front to make you less excited about them actually reaching their ceiling and being like, okay, there's a league average third baseman, I guess. And that's a little bit less to dream on, I think, for what should have been what seemed like a seller's market.
Well, Jarrell Perez, he was the 18th ranked prospect, according to Baseball America, as Baseball America's updated their top 30s before the trade deadline. So that's why we are referencing Baseball America in these rankings. 19 years old. He's having a good year at A-ball, 75 games this season, hitting .264 with a .380 on base percentage. That's a good number to see. Slugging .420. He's got 10 homers and 15 doubles. Again, he's just 19 years old. Alexander Albertus is the 16th ranked Dodgers prospect. 19 years old, not having as much success in A-ball. He's only played 19 games. However, Albertus is out for the rest of the season, as our James Fegan tweeted that Albertus has a stress reaction in his left tibia. So we won't see Albertus for the rest of the year. We'll see him in 2025 and see if that impacts him. So the White Sox get two 19-year-olders, and of course, one of them is injured. And
Then White Sox have an awesome track record when it comes to picking up injured players and expecting them to bounce right back to what they were.
So the headliner for the White Sox and why, if this deal is going to work and why they made this deal, is Miguel Vargas. He is the headliner. My concern, though, Jim, is that you're going to hear a lot of people publicize this trade about the prospect ranking Vargas had not that long ago, considered one of the top prospects in Major League Baseball. But that prospect shine has worn off during his limited time with the Los Angeles Dodgers. He's only had 80 plate appearances in 2024. He's been somewhat productive. He's got a 108 weighted runs created plus in those plate appearances. So he's been batting slightly above league average. He's got a 736 OPS with three home runs. However, he had more runway in 2023. He played 81 games, 304 plate appearances, batted 195 with a 305 on base percentage, and slugged 367, which, gosh, would fit great with the 2025 White Sox hitters. And there's two reasons why the prospect shine has worn off. One, Vargas doesn't have a defensive home. The Dodgers have tried to play him at second base. That didn't work out. They moved him to left field. According to a Dodgers source, that has been an adventure for Vargas out in left field. Best guess is that first base is long-term or maybe just a DH. So for a White Sox team that was set out to be better defensively and is the worst defense in Major League Baseball, and as we record this podcast, it's during Monday night's White Sox-Royals game, and even though the White Sox are winning right now, they've already committed two throwing errors, so it's not like the defense is getting better as the season progresses. That surprises me a bit of the limited defensive value Vargas provides. Now, the hope is the bat. But there is a gigantic red flag with Miguel Vargas, and this is something that both Vargas and the White Sox are going to have to work on. Jim, Vargas has trouble with the fastball against right-handed pitching, and Vargas is a right-handed batter. And in 2023, playing half the season against fastballs from right-handed pitchers. He batted only 205, slugged 384. He saw fastball 62% of the time in his plate appearances. His average exit velocity against those pitches was just 86 miles per hour. And it's worse when it's four-seam fastballs. He only batted 161 against four-seam fastballs from right-handed pitchers and whiffed 25% of the time. He only hit one home run in 2023 against a righty off a four-seam fastball. This season, small sample size, but in bats that have finished with a four-seam fastball from right-handed pitchers, Vargas is 1-for-10 with 5 strikeouts. And against right-handed pitching in 105 major league games, Vargas is batting 198 with a 295 on-base percentage and slugging just 336. That's a 631 OPS against right-handed pitchers in the major leagues. If you're not scared already and have shut this podcast off and started curling into a ball and cry, why the White Sox have hope, or at least holding out for hope, is the AAA numbers for Vargas are fantastic. This season, in 41 games in AAA in the Pacific Coast League, Vargas is batting 290 with a 440 on base percentage and slugging 566. So maybe Vargas can hit, Jim, but it brings into question with this type of return for the White Sox, and we knew that they needed to add more position players into their system. Shouldn't they have gotten someone that's a more for sure thing than Miguel Vargas for Erick Fedde? I think that's where I'm going to land on if this trade is successful or not for the White Sox. Because 19-year-olds in A-ball, we got 2, maybe 3 more years to figure out if they are anything yet and can contribute to the major leagues for the White Sox. Mm-hmm. But in the immediate future, I feel like we're going to see a lot of Miguel Vargas. And if Vargas continues to struggle like he has with the Dodgers against fastballs from right-handed pitchers, this trade could get ugly.
Yeah, I don't mind Vargas individually. It feels a little bit like Marco Patti always gets his guy, just with the profile.
Because he's Cuban.
Yeah, $300,000 signing. You know, not an older Cuban like he was signed after his age 17 season in Cuba. Made his pro debut in 18. So not the 22-year-old that Patti was known for signing, but Vargas is 24 now, so it does kind of arrive at that same timetable as Yoelki Cespedes and Yolbert Sanchez and so forth. So there's a little bit of that I have to set aside because that's unfair to him, because who knows, maybe Patti doesn't like him and this is Chris Getz going on his own. But it feels like if the White Sox got him for, say, Robbie Grossman or Tommy Pham on his own, or Michael Kopech on his own, like, I figure, yeah, great deal. Like, it's worth giving a shot. The White Sox, their biggest asset now is playing time, the ability to audition guys, ability to have judgment free at bats. So sure, you know, have somebody who's been on the cusp of sticking, has had plenty of AAA success or enough to feel encouraged by, and then give him a bats and give him a bats again and move him around positions and try to see if something sticks. We're kind of talking about Lenin Sosa the more I talk about this, but still, it's a case of, you know, you're not personally experienced with Lenin Sosa's the things that make him frustrating. So sure, you'll give him that playing time. But to me, when I think about Fedde being traded, and if you kind of individualize the returns, if you think of it like as Fedde for one player and Pham for one player and Kopech for one player, it's not as impressive as the deal with the Angels last year when Lucas Giolito and Reynaldo Lopez cut Kai Bush and Edgar Caro. Because that felt like a good deal at the time, because Caro felt like a little bit like a depressed asset. But, again, double A. So in that time frame of don't need him to be great immediately, don't need him to.
And there was the question, he was being rushed by the Angels.
Yep. So but in a case of like Giolito for Caro, great. Lopez for Bush, great. Those felt like pretty good returns individually on each of those players. And when you combine them from the same team, awesome. So like that's kind of what I'm judging against when it comes to deadlines. And maybe, there wasn't that mark at the deadline this year. Desperate Angels team trying to make anything of Shohei Ohtani's last months in an Angels uniform. But If that's the precedent, you know, then going from that to having a Fedde Kopech Pham deal that, if you even break it down individually, is meh at best, then it is disappointing.
Yeah, to send out three players and only get three prospects in return for, I mean, Erick Fedde, Baseball Reference loves Erick Fedde. He's like worth 4.6 WAR according to Baseball Reference. Fangraphs, not as high. He's at 2.7 WAR, but that's still good for top 20 in all of Major League Baseball. According to WAR, Erick Fedde is the 19th ranked starting pitcher in Major League Baseball. It just feels like you could have got more than even what the Dodgers offered. Like, if this is what the Dodgers offered for Erick Fedde, okay, maybe we can have a discussion that this could work out for the White Sox. They got three position players. One is Major League ready. Two are lottery tickets, guys that maybe the White Sox can dream on at 19 years old. But then you throw in Kopech and you throw in Pham. And the fact that Fedde and Pham are going to St. Louis and you get nothing from St. Louis, I just feel like the more I think about this deal and we talk about it, Jim, the White Sox are short one to two more players, and those players should be coming from St. Louis. Like, I feel like the White Sox should have gotten Matthew Liberatore from St. Louis as part of this trade. That's someone that we have talked about in the past about hypotheticals with a Erick Fedde to St. Louis type of trade. That's just, the more I think about it, it just feels like it's short. You could have gotten more out of this three-team trade than what Chris Getz was able to do.
It feels like when you leave a takeout establishment without checking the bag, and then you come home, open up, and like, oh, didn't we order spring rolls, or didn't we order, like, where's... We had six items, right? Why are there only four? And then you kind of have to weigh, like, do I go back? Do I call? Do I bother? Just, you know, write it up as not checking, not doing due diligence before leaving the place. And yeah, it does feel a little bit like that.
I mean, if Miguel Vargas joins the White Sox and gets on a tear, and again, Chris Getz, to the point you just made, Jim, they're going to give as much runway as possible to Vargas. So we're going to see a lot of Miguel Vargas post-trade deadline. We're going to see a lot of them in August and September. And hopefully he finds more success again, especially against right-handed pitchers, especially against right-handed pitchers that are throwing fastballs at him. If he can't hit the fastball, he's going to be a quadruple A player. This is not going to work. I don't like his chances of sticking to the majors. It's just a fact. If you don't hit the fastball in the majors, what chance do you got, especially with all the spin that we're seeing from sliders these days? Like, it's so tough for everyone in Major League Baseball to hit breaking pitches. You have to capitalize on your opportunity to hit velocity. So we'll see what adjustments Vargas makes with the hitting coaches for the White Sox that are currently coaching the worst offense in our lifetime. Maybe something will click when Vargas joins the White Sox, and maybe just more playing time gives him an opportunity to actually meet some of his future potential. So that's the first trade that the White Sox have made. Chris Getz is suggesting that his work is not done, that he's still working and trying to get another couple of deals done before the deadline. So what's next for the White Sox? Well, immediately the attention goes to Garrett Crochet. Chris Getz was asked about during the same pregame media conference when talking about the three-team trade. He was asked about Garrett Crochet and his contract extension demands.
It's tough to tell at this point because the trade deadline is not, you know, we're not at the deadline quite yet. You know, I Garrett and I, you know, I felt like we've had a really strong relationship back to when we drafted him. And, you know, I think about, you know, the alternate site, and, you know, he made his major league debut, you know, so quickly without any minor league games. And I remember driving over here, he had never been to a major league park, and being with him and kind of going through that experience with him, you know, getting acclimated to the major leagues and, you know, going through his injuries and you know, his decision along with mine to go into this year preparing to be a starter and giving him a chance to do that. I'm really, you know, I continue to feel that we have really open and honest relationship, and certainly I believe in Garrett, and he goes out, whether I believe in him or not doesn't matter, because he believes in himself as a pitcher. The communication had been very strong between Garrett and I and you know, his agency. And, you know, I was a little surprised and taken back by how they went about it. You know, considering that I had a conversation with his agent, you know, the night before, I didn't, you know, that's not exactly the tactic that I would have taken, you know, even being a former player, quite honestly. You know, just because the dialogue had been so honest and real and careful and mindful of his career, because, you know, I've known him since we got him. So I was a little surprised by it. I was. I think most people, most fans, and even players, you know, without knowing everything, it makes sense. I think we understand, you know, why a stance would be taken like that. Now, how you go about expressing that is what was, you know, a bit hurtful, quite honestly, considering I felt like we could have handled it a little bit differently and still, I think, everyone accomplished what they wanted to accomplish. So, you know, but I you know, Garrett's a very talented arm, and he's just getting his starting career going. And, you know, he's looking out for his long-term well-being. We fully understand and support that, and we'll continue to do so. But the belief that we didn't have his best intentions in mind, I think, was what I was a little surprised by with how it was handled. But, you know, we're Garrett and I are fine. We are good. I'll continue to be one of his top supporters. And, you know, in regards to how it affects his you know, the coming days, tough to tell.
Now, Jim, it sounds like two things to me when Getz is talking about Crochet. One, Getz was truly caught off guard by the public reports on Crochet's desire for a contract extension if he was traded. And it has caused issues in trying to move Crochet now, as opposing teams or buying teams that were interested in Crochet have a lot of questions for Chris Getz. Second, it seems that Getz is a bit sore from this entire ordeal, but proclaims that Crochet and him are still on good terms. So while I don't think a Crochet deal gets done by the deadline, I would be surprised now if Crochet pitches for the White Sox in 2025. Like, this could have been the way that CAA handled this and Crochet handled it, at least from Chris Getz's point of view, may have caused unnecessary friction.
Yeah, it's confusing, just because I understand Crochet's concerns that he's built up this workload very carefully. He's having the success he always dreamed of. And he doesn't want to be traded to Dodgers or Brewers or just like some team that's, you know, has major goals and just gets thrown into, are going to be throwing three innings on back-to-back days because it's the playoffs. It's all hands on deck. And, you know, he thinks his body won't respond. And so he wants the acquiring team to have some amount of care that the White Sox have shown him, and he doesn't want to be completely thrown off. So I get that, but it does feel poorly handled. Even like, you know, setting aside Chris Getz's part, because I don't exactly know, like, what, you know, I don't know if I should give him the benefit of the doubt, because, you know, Crochet has not commented. So I'm only speaking in terms of like me, a baseball fan, trying to see this as like a third party, perhaps a team that's, you know, potentially excited about acquiring Crochet and seeing a guy who wants an extension or won't pitch in October and thinking like, why wouldn't he want to pitch in October? Like, why wouldn't he be excited about the opportunity to pitch for a contender? And I think we saw that last year with Eduardo Rodriguez, was it? I'm trying to think.
Oh, yes. He shot down a trade. I think, was it to the Dodgers?
Yes.
When he was in Detroit.
I think so, yes. From the Tigers, yes. So, and invited the same questions. Ultimately, he got paid the next year, and so people set it aside. But I think it was just he'd been going through a lot and felt comfortable in Detroit and really didn't want to. You know, he had absorbed those questions and overcame it. So I think, like, Crochet will do, you know, probably do well to as long as he finishes the year strong, you know, do the same. But it did, you know, I don't know if it's smart to be able to put that out there in a way that makes you feel like October is not important, because that just especially as a first impression to another fan base that might be interested in picking up Crochet. Like, wait, this is the guy who didn't want to pitch in October? And it's not quite as simple as that, but also it does boil down to that in a way. Just saying that, if he comes to a team and is going to say, like, I'll pitch through September, but then you guys are on your own. Like, that doesn't... I can't imagine that reflects well to teammates either. So it is messy, even before you get to Getz and what Getz said he knew or didn't know. For Getz's part, I think combined with the trade that, you know, the return on paper at least isn't that impressive. It does. It creates this picture that he might be a little bit in over his head right now. Kind of my first thought is he cut out for this? If he's, expressing befuddlement and distress over what one of his players took, one of his players' agencies took to the public without him knowing, and then he goes and swings a deal where, like, he looks like he's on the wrong side of it. Is he cut out to do this? Like, that's a really rough... And if that's the case, like, sure, hold on to Crochet. Do not trade him right now because you are not in the headspace to do it, is my first impression.
Well, he doesn't have a lot of time.
He'll have plenty of value after the season if he gets through it healthy. My favorite part, I think, or subplot, I should say, is when Getz was asked about, like, well, can't you extend him yourself and enjoy a good pitcher for longer than he's currently under team control? Scott Merkin relayed the tweet that I'm looking at saying, there's a chance he's still with us right now. He's a guy that is continuing to become one of the top arms in the game, and we certainly value that. But it also goes back to what's best for long-term health of the White Sox. And that didn't inspire confidence. That's very much a out of the Rick Hahn playbook of, or Kenny Williams did the same thing. If we extend our players, we can't pay perhaps one of our mystery good players who pops up. There always needs to be flexibility for a move that won't be made. And so that's, I think, maybe of all, everything that happened in those short few hours this afternoon, that's the one I think that made me roll my eyes the most is pulling a page straight from, like, the we need to maintain all long-term flexibility, and we make sure that we can pay all our good players whenever we get them. If we get them, we don't have them yet. Am I capable of getting them? I don't know.
I wonder what the end game is after the trade deadline with Crochet, like how the White Sox handle Crochet. Like, to me, it seems like August and September is more opportunities to continue building on that resume, continue building innings, and using that film when you go to the GM meetings in November and you speak to your colleagues when Major League Baseball is sharing what the rule updates are and the operations for the upcoming season. That Getz is telling everyone outside of, again, I don't like our team and we're going to try to look to improve it. In Scottsdale, Arizona, letting teams know, yeah, Crochet is definitely available. We are looking to move Crochet. Like, for White Sox fans, it's like, oh, cool, they kept Crochet. I would like them to keep Crochet. I'm just getting this, like, my spidey senses are tingling. We've been down this path before for the Chicago White Sox organization, even though it's, quote unquote, somebody new. It's not Rick Hahn, but it is Chris Getz that's saying this, that I just get the vibes that Crochet is definitely going to be dealt before 2025 opening day. So if they don't trade him by the deadline on Tuesday, we're going to be playing this game again in the offseason, and everyone on Sox Machine can contemplate in their offseason plan projects what kind of return that they would try to get for Garrett Crochet. Who knows? Maybe Getz can throw in Luis Robert, a couple other players, trade three major leaguers to get three prospects back.
Yep.
I'm starting to lean towards not liking this trade the White Sox made.
Yeah, it's a case of because they're 19, you don't want to say anything that ages terribly, like old takes exposed. Because there is the ability that they get better. The Dodgers have traded guys who have become huge stars. So, they don't have 100% hit rate on evaluating their own players. And partially it's because they already have players at positions and they don't really need many more and can deal from depth. And that's what happens when you deal from depth sometimes. But leave it open for 19-year-olds to surprise and become good major leaguers, but we'll see what happens, I think, between now and the rest of the, how many hours we have left, like 18 hours before the deadline, that, we'll see what the market yields for other starting pitchers and then make our best guesses as to whether Getz got fair value or whether he maybe just got a little bit, I don't want to get in a headspace and say like, do armchair psychology, but at least, when it comes to packaging Kopech and Pham and Fedde and making it, real convenient, I do wonder if there's like a little bit of like this is going really well, getting wrapped up in how everything's fitting together and realizing like, actually by packaging these three players, kind of came away a little bit light. Kind of like when you sell a car to CarMax, trade it in rather than sell it yourself, private sale. You cost yourself some money for the convenience of it, and that's kind of what it feels like here.
Do you see Chris Getz making any moves before the deadline, Jim? Is there anyone that's obvious that the White Sox have not traded yet that could be dealt?
Seems like DeYoung could find a taker just for some team that needs somebody, whether it's like a player to be named later or A-ball. Yeah. And what's also confusing about this trade for Fedde is like you say, A-ball lottery ticket, and the two prospects acquired are pretty much A-ball lottery tickets. You may be a little bit more certain, but still far away, especially with Albertus, the injury concerns that you'd be trading DeYoung for somebody like that. That's not a whole lot encouraging. Maybe DeYoung goes for like the 24-year-old live arm that is going to be a 40-man roster concern and get squeezed out. Like maybe that's more fitting. So I could see him going. Lopez, I don't know if he's done enough. Yeah, he's good in the bench role, but also when he's stealing bases at less than a 50% clip, I think maybe that just reduces his value for doing anything besides being like a second division utility guy. Flexen pitched pretty well tonight, but I don't know if he'll find a home. So I think Crochet Roberts might be too complicated to pull off. So yeah, maybe I'll just say DeYoung and leave it at that.
What about Brebbia?
Oh, Brebbia. Yeah, I forgot about him. So yes, I think he could find taker as well.
Yeah, I figured that would be the one deal that I expect the White Sox to make on Tuesday, is that John Brebbia gets traded. I don't know what they would get in return for Brebbia, but yeah, I'm expecting Brebbia to get dealt. But we do have a trade to talk about. There's been lively conversations on SoxMachine.com. Greatly appreciate everybody hanging out in the comments. And again, we'll have more news if the White Sox do make another trade or any trades around Major League Baseball before the deadline on Tuesday at 5 p.m. Central Time. Check us out for our live show. We'll be streaming starting at 4 p.m. Central Time to 5 p.m. Central Time on youtube.com/SoxMachine. You can join us, you can listen to us, you can watch us as we watch the final hour, which could be chaotic around Major League Baseball for trades coming in at the last minute. And Jim and I will also be joining Dan Bernstein and Lawrence Holmes on Bernstein and Holmes, 670 The Score. You could also listen on the Odyssey app. We will be on around 1220, 1225 to break down the White Sox trades that they have made so far. So there you go. A couple ways that you can listen and watch us tomorrow. Everything about the upcoming trade deadline for the Chicago White Sox and Major League Baseball. But that will do it for this episode of the Sox Machine Podcast, at least this special edition. Thank you so much for listening. If you just discovered the Sox Machine Podcast, you can subscribe to the show wherever you listen to podcasts, such as Spotify and Apple Music. You can also watch the show and listen to us at youtube.com/SoxMachine. And continue following us on social media. We're at Sox Machine. You can follow me at SoxMachine_Josh. And follow James Fegan at JR Fegan, as he'll gather more intel and news from the White Sox clubhouse. If you enjoy our work at Sox Machine and like to help support us, you can by signing up at patreon.com/SoxMachine. Patreon supporters get ad-free versions of both the podcast and website. We also have additional benefits as well, including our Veterans Committee, where they have a group chat feature to be with Jim, myself, and James. James actually shared a text message Monday morning from a source that this three-team trade was coming down the pipe. So our VC members got a hint that this was coming before it got announced. So if you are interested in that type of coverage and access, again, you can acquire at patreon.com/SoxMachine. The Sox Machine Podcast is a production of SoxMachine.com, your home for all things Chicago White Sox baseball and part of the Blue Wire Podcast Network. Alongside Jim Margalus, I'm Josh Nelson. Thanks for listening and watching.